Hi everyone, evening. Well, at least it's evening right now as you listen to this, if you're watching the Premier. It's middle of the day for me. As I mentioned this morning, that we'll be recording tonight, as I generally spend Friday nights with the family doing some fun stuff. So just going to give a few minutes for people as they are arriving. I never know what to say in these bits. It's really embarrassing, isn't it? I hope that you're all okay. I hope you've had a great day today. I think it's been quite nice, quite warm. I've been busy getting ready for Sunday. Hopefully, I'll have some time to finish filling my skip. And that can go then. Maybe one day I'll show you the garden work I've been doing. It's been quite heavy going this week. Just give it a little bit more longer. If you've already joined me, then hi. Thanks for joining me. It's great to see you. Just going to give it just to the end of this minute. So we'll wait just a couple of minutes. Most people arrive in the first couple of minutes. So maybe comment right now if what you've been doing today. If you've done anything interesting, let us know what you've been doing. Just while we're waiting for others to join us. All right, I think maybe we'll just crack on, eh? Don't forget, though, that Mystery Devotion is tomorrow, and you don't want to miss these ones. These are ones that you won't have heard of before. And I know many of you who don't really know us, you know, it's always new, I suppose, for you, the Mystery Devotioner. But these ones are people who I think you'll be really happy to see. So, yeah, please do tune in tomorrow, 10 a.m. and also 7:30. And then, of course, church on Sunday, 11 o'clock on Facebook Live and YouTube Live. And hey, we feel so blessed that we're able to continue to bring the Sunday services to you, and we're so grateful for the people that are investing in that, and you know, the worship teams and the preachers and stuff that are all involved, and the people sending us greeting videos and everything. It's just great to still be able in this time of isolation to keep going, and to be hopefully to encourage some people and to have some time together to worship and to fellowship. Right, so I'm going to crack on with it anyway. We're looking at Judges today, as you know, Judges 16. It's actually the last of the Judges that we're going to be reading to you, because tomorrow we're going to start on Ruth. So we're finishing off Samson's story, and it's the part of his story that everyone will know. It's Samson and Delilah. Oh, Samson's downfall. So this is chapter 16. As I said, we're going to read the whole chapter together. And I've just got a couple of things I want to bring out. And as per this morning, I'm going to aim to be done in 10 minutes. No more than 10 minutes. So here we go. Samson 16 says, one day Samson went to Gaza, where he saw a prostitute. He went in to spend the night with her. Good old Samson. Just kind of ignoring every rule, everything that he's been asked not to do. He just goes and does it anyway. I mean that in a bad way. You know, he's certainly not someone that we would want to copy, or he wouldn't be an example for us for how to live a right life, unfortunately. But he is an example of how God can use it in spite of that. But it says, when the people of Gaza were told that Samson is here, they surrounded the place and lay in wait for him all night at the city gate. They made no move during the night, saying, at dawn, we'll kill him. But Samson lay there only until the middle of the night. Then he got up and took hold of the doors of the city gate, together with the two posts, and tore them loose, bar and all. He lifted them to his shoulders and carried them to the top of the hill that faces Hebron. Sometime later, he fell in love with a woman in the valley of Sorek, whose name was Delilah. I want to go dun 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 at that point. So the rulers of the Philistines went to her and said, see if you can lure him into showing you the secret of his great strength, and how we can overpower him so we may tie him up and subdue him. Each of us will give you 1,100 shekels of silver. So Delilah said to Samson, tell me the secret of your great strength and how you can be tied up and subdued. Samson answered her, if anyone ties me with 7 fresh thongs that have not been dried, I'll become as weak as any other man. Then the rulers of the Philistines brought their seven fresh thongs that had not been dried. This is the like leather strips, okay? That had not been dried. And she tied him with them. With men hidden in the room, she called to him, "Samson, the Philistines are upon you." But he snapped the thongs as easily as a piece of string snaps when it comes close to a flame. So the secret of his strength was not discovered. Then Delilah said to Samson, "You have made a fool of me. You lied to me. How come? Come now, tell me how you can be tied." What a strange thing to say. "You have made a fool of me." Kind of shows the fact that actually she was embarrassed because she told them the wrong information. So she's kind of almost admitted, holding the hand and saying, "You know, I told these guys what your secret was. And obviously it wasn't your secret, and I'm so embarrassed by that." That's really, really just a weird conversation to be having, I would have thought, with someone who essentially should be looking at her and thinking, "You're not really on my side here." So she said, he said, verse 11, "If anyone ties me securely with new ropes that have never been used, I'll become as weak as any other man." So Delilah took new ropes and tied him with them. Then the men hidden in the room, she called to him, "Samson, the Philistines are upon you." But he snapped the ropes off his arms as if they were threads. Delilah then said to Samson, "Until now you have been making a fool of me and lying to me. Tell me how you can be tied." Wow, again, really, really suspect motives. He replied, "If you weave the seven braids of my hair into the fabric on the loom and tighten it with a pin, I'll become as weak as any other man." So while they were sleeping, Delilah took the seven braids off his head, wove them into the fabric and tightened it with a pin. Again, she called to him, "Samson, the Philistines are upon you." He woke from his sleep and pulled up the pin and the loom with the fabric. So not only has he been betrayed another time, but now his hair's all tangled. Things just aren't looking good for him. Then she said to him, "How can you say I love you?" Wow, can you hear the manipulation in that? "How can you say I love you when you won't confide in me?" This is someone who every time he's confided in her, he's being betrayed. And she's saying, "How can you say you love me if you won't confide in me? This is the third time you have made a fool of me and haven't told me the secret of your strength." With such nagging, she prodded him day after day until he was tired to death. So he told her everything. "No razor has ever been used on my head," he said, "because I have been a Nazarite, set apart to God since birth. If my head was shaved, my strength would leave me and I would become as weak as any other man." I have some experience in this because I eventually succumbed to Leah wanting to shave my hair. She took quite a bit off the sides and the back. I think she did a decent job, but I certainly have noticed a reduction in my strength. But luckily, I'm still quite strong. So he told her everything. So then Delilah saw that he had told her everything. She sent word to the rulers of the Philistines, "Come back once more. He has told me everything." So the rulers of the Philistines returned with the silver in their hands. Having put him to sleep on her lap, she called a man to shave off the seven braids of his hair, and so began to subdue him, and his strength left him. Then she called, "Samson, the Philistines are upon you." He woke from his sleep and thought, "I'll go out as before and shake myself free." But he did not know that the Lord had left him. Then the Philistines seized him, gouged out his eyes, and took him down to Gaza, binding him with bronze shackles. They set him to grinding in the prison, but the hair on his head began to grow again after it had been shaved. Do you want to stop there for a second? I haven't got much time actually looking at it. There's quite a bit to read. But what stands out in this passage is that Samson, he just had the wrong people in his life. This is somebody who was trying to hurt him. It was obvious. I almost think that he was stupid to tell her. Because, you know, three times he told her a fake answer and three times he'd been attacked. What was he expecting would happen? It's almost like he willingly went back and allowed her to hurt him. And I want to just tell you that, you know, our relationships are so important. So important. we've got to be really careful about the people we put around us. Samson, the strongest man in the world, Succoth was beaten. Not by someone stronger, not by some mighty weapon, but by a bad relationship. Our relationships can make and break us. And I want to say in a positive way that I am so incredibly grateful for the people that I've got around me. I thank God for the people God's put in my life. I can't think where I would be without the support of some of the guys in my life. You know, I don't want to go through a big long list, but you know, the leadership team, just so incredibly grateful for how supportive they are of Leah and I. The trustees, so incredibly grateful of how they support us and support the church. And my family and my friends and other people and the other leaders in the church, so incredibly grateful that these guys around me who are just seeking to lift us up and build us up and to see the church succeed. So incredible. But and like I said, family and friends. Oh my goodness, me and Leah wouldn't have had half the life we've had without my people like my mum and dad babysitting, you know, every single Friday night. And Leah's mum and family, you know, we just wouldn't have been able to do what we've been able to do. But I want to highlight just two people to you, actually, because I've never actually said this publicly. But I really, really, really appreciate my brother James and my sister-in-law, Sarah. Because, man, they're just like, literally, they will drop everything to come. If we're in trouble, they will drop everything to support us and help us. They're part of the leadership as well. They're one of the leaders in the church. So they serve the church with passion and with diligence. And it's almost like I know without a shadow of a doubt, whatever happens in life, them two will be there to support. And there's other people like that in our life as well. But I just want to say thank you, James and Sarah, for everything you've done for me and Leah. Because, you know, the fact that we can confide in you, you are not just family, but your friends, the people that I can, not just family, but friends. But you know what I mean? That we consider you to be friends and we love you so much. And, you know, you need people like that in your life. You need people in your life who want to support you, build you up. And if you're in relationships with people that pull you down, that wear you out, that actually left you feeling drained and tired and clearly have got their own motives, clearly out to manipulate you, just get rid of him and put people around you. Now, I'm not saying for 1 minute we don't go to people who are like that and we don't try and help those people and we don't love those people, but don't for your own sake allow those people into that special place in your life. Put other people in there who are going to build you up and help you. Also, there's a line there, it says, a verse there, it says, he did not know that the Lord had left him. I think that's a real warning to us. We can't be complacent. Get focused on God all the time. Don't allow him to slip away and a distance to grow between you and not even realize. And before you know it, you're thinking, where is God? Where is God right now in my life? Samson, strongest man in the world, he woke up. He didn't even know that God had left him. Just carry on real quick, I'm running out of time. It says, now the rulers of the Philistines assembled to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon, their god, and to celebrate, saying, our God has delivered Samson, our enemy, into our hands. When the people saw him, they praised their God, saying, our God has delivered our enemy into your hands. The one who lay waste to our land has multiplied and multiplied our slain. While they were in high spirits, they shouted, bring out Samson to entertain us. So they called Samson out of the prison and he performed for them. When they stood him among the pillars, Samson said to the servant who held his hand, put me where I can feel the pillars that support the temple so I may lean against them. Now the temple was crowded with men and women. All the rulers of the Philistines were there, and on the roof were about 3,000 men and women watching Samson perform. When Samson prayed to the Lord, O sovereign Lord, remember me, O God. Please strengthen me just one more time and let me, with one blow, get revenge on the Philistines for my two eyes. Then Samson reached towards the two central pillars on which the temple stood, bracing himself against them, his right hand on one, his left hand on the other. Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. And then he pushed with all his might and came down the temple. And down came the temple on the rulers and all the people in it. Thus he killed many more when he died than when he lived. Then his brothers and his father's family went down to get him. They brought him back and buried him between Zorah and Eshtol in the tomb of Manoah's father. He had led Israel 20 years. One final thought. I don't want to keep much longer. is that Samson did so much more at the end of his life there than he ever had done in his entire life. And it's just a real encouragement to think it's never too late. It's never too late for God to do something powerful in your life. Don't think it's over. Don't think that you've missed your chance. Put your trust back in him. Samson, he prayed to God. He said, God, give me back that strength. And if you can do the same thing right now, if you feel that you've missed your chance, if you feel that you've missed opportunities, if you feel that your life's coming to an end maybe, and you're thinking, what have I done? I want to encourage you, go to God. Say, God, give me this, give me that strength again. Let's go again. And actually, believe that God will do more with you in this season of your life than the whole of the rest of your life put together. God can do it. He's not restricted by age, gender, race, language. He's not restricted by anything. He is God, and he can do amazing things through you, because it's not about you. It's about his strength and his glory. 16 minutes, longer than I wanted to be. So we're going to leave it there. We just pray for you, and then you can enjoy the rest of your evening. We thank you, God, because you are our Father in heaven. You are our God. And Lord, we pray for real wisdom, Lord, as we are looking at our relationships. Lord, help us to put people around us that really support and build us up and grow, and that we can support and build up back. Lord, help us to have just relationships that are mutually beneficial, that really help each other. And Lord, if we're struggling with people in our lives, Lord, help us have wisdom to know how to deal with those people. Help us to have wisdom to know when we need to cut off people, if you like, people who are dangerous to us, who cause damage, who are out to manipulate and out for selfish goals, Father. Help us to build real good relationships that are mutually supportive, that are mutually dependent on each other, and that, Lord, bring us such life and joy and peace. And Lord, as well, for those of us who maybe feel as if they've missed opportunity, for those of us who feel as if they've messed up even maybe, or maybe just at a point in their life where they think, gosh, you know, where's my life gone? What else can I do for God? I really pray, Lord, you encourage those people right now and say it's never too late. God is with you now, as much as he ever has been with you. And Lord, just I pray you encourage those people in that, and they'll come back to you, Lord, and the faith will be raised to do and to see even more amazing things. In Jesus' mighty name we ask it. Amen. Amen. All right, don't forget Mystery Devotions tomorrow. Don't miss that. Church on Sunday at 11. Have a great weekend, and see you when I see you. Bye.